Hey, guys.
Hey.
How you doing? Come on in.
Black executives. Still a relatively rare breed in corporate America, but maybe, just maybe, a key to this country's industrial competitiveness.
We in the African-American community understand the need for diversity. We've understood it for a long time.
What's the central question again?
We've been trying to get in. But the question is, does America understand the need for diversity? And are they ready to embrace diversity for the strength of America?
Richard, who? We don't want it!
This may be the most successful group of black managers in corporate America. Executives past and present of the Xerox Corporation. They call themselves the Roadshow because they're on the road constantly pushing the idea that America's ethnic diversity is a competitive strength, not a weakness.
Are you from Richmond?
Yeah.
They converged on Boston because tomorrow, every MBA student at the Harvard Business School will hear them tell the case history of the black network at Xerox.
Xerox senior management, in its infinite wisdom, somewhere along the line said, we're going to empower these men and their associates to be who and what they are. And we weren't really sure where that was going to take us. They weren't sure, we weren't sure. But what they did was say that we're going to trust it, trust you, and empower you to be African Americans and bring that to the table. And it worked.
Compared to the rest of corporate America, Xerox's success at promoting African Americans in the past 20 years has been graphic. Any way you count it, blacks make up less than 6% of U.S. management. At Xerox, more than 11% of all managers are African American. More revealing still is a comparison of top managers. Here, the national average appears to be around 0.5% for blacks, 1% for minorities in general. At Xerox, by contrast, of 196 top executives, fully 9% are black, 17% minority. At Xerox, they say they're not just trying to fill affirmative action quotas. At every level, the company claims to be getting the loyalty and sense of corporate community that's usually associated with the Japanese.
We made a pact back in 1972, 1973. I mean, the same group of guys here and some that are not here, that we would never compete against each other. And do you know how difficult that is in a corporate setting for people to say they're not going to compete against each other when we were all competing for the same jobs, essentially? And you know what? We never did. And we all basically got our vice presidencies or the directorships or plant managers or whatever area we were at, because we always knew that our back was covered. In other words, we didn't have to look behind us because we knew everybody that we loved was in front of us.
The Roadshow member who's risen highest thus far is Barry Rand, president of marketing at Xerox and one of its half dozen or so top executives.
Madam, Mr. President.
In Japan, workers join firms for life and form their own interpersonal networks. Rand says that's happening with blacks at Xerox.
In the black culture, just so happens that the major strategy that has allowed black people to flourish, to survive and then flourish, happens to be one of unity. We know that we historically have never been able to make it unless we unify and help ourselves.
I can't type. I don't take dictation.
In its sensitivity to women and minorities, Xerox has had to come a long way, as this early TV ad makes pretty clear.
My boss calls me indispensable.
Miss Jones.
Just a minute.
Will you make a copy of this?
But at Xerox, they've made an unprecedented effort, begun in the late 60s, only a few years after this ad campaign, to get minorities to the top. Former CEO David Kearns.
We looked at where had the white male managers that were running the corporation come from. And we spotted those jobs and said, these are the kinds of experiences that you need if you're going to run a corporation like Xerox. As a result, then, we said, over the years, we're going to have women and minorities in those feeder jobs if we're ever going to have a broad range of executives to run the business. And that's exactly what we did.
In corporate America as a whole, after years of uniformity, companies have finally begun to recognize the need for diversity. Unfortunately, many of the attempts are half-hearted, if not half-baked. Tacos in the company cafeteria, for instance, or the promotion of a few token minority members to executive slots created just for them. At Xerox, however, they claim they're trying not just to cope with America's ethnic diversity, but to capitalize on it. Minorities are encouraged to use their ethnicity as a source of mutual support, of group identity, of corporate identity. African Americans do it through a network known as the Black Caucus. Downtown New York, 5 p.m. Xerox middle manager Val Mason has driven in from her Long Island office to help fellow Xerox blacks get ahead. This evening, she's teaching management skills.
As a manager, and you're sitting in your office, and you get one of your employees walking in, and they close the door and start screaming at you, I don't need for you to get up and punch that employee out.
These after-hour self-help groups started at Xerox back in the 70s with the Roadshow. The caucuses are organized by members of different minority groups. They're voluntary, they're on personal time.
How have you handled having to give presentations to potentially a hostile audience, such as majority males?
You should, if you're the presenter, take control. If you've got people in the audience that are hacklers or, you know, doing all the things to distract you because they know that they want to challenge you, you may have to stop the presentation and just say, Danielle, is there something that you want to say?
While some critics might think racial caucuses are divisive, President Barry Rand thinks they teach their members important skills, thus benefiting the firm as a whole.
In the district in Washington, D.C., we had a sales rep that was failing. The other six sales reps went into the person's territory to help the person get more prospects, qualify the prospects, demonstrate them so that the person could get more orders, so the person could be more successful, and so the person could avoid either critiquing or making less money. Where in America would you find six people who would go and help another sales rep in the territory? An example of an expression of black pride, unity, and the value of excelling.
What Barry's talking about happened all over the country. It happened in Los Angeles, where Bernard was, San Francisco, where I was, New York, where Art was. Everywhere in the country, this was a common practice.
There are now 12,000 blacks at Xerox. 25% of its employees are minority members. To some, this is a multicultural success story. But with Hispanics and women now forming caucuses of their own, there's the potential for separatism within the firm. To Viet Warren, however, this is just networking, and it's all to the good.
Why is it threatening if I do it when you've been doing it all your life? You don't consider the good old boy network threatening. Why? Because you're a member of it.
Warren, with six promotions in 13 years, is on the fast track at Xerox. To keep moving up the ranks, she relies on black caucus members like Al Martins, with whom she feels comfortable discussing ethnic problems.
Hey, you know, I don't want to get in your personal life, but have you decided yet where you're going to live?
Warren works at Xerox headquarters in Rochester, New York, where there are very few eligible black men. Commutes home to the New York City area every weekend.
So my decision is not to move to Rochester, not permanently. And I really have been struggling because as a single black female, Rochester is not conducive to my lifestyle.
Does that being away cause you from not having an after five cocktail some evenings with some of the guys and some of the girls around the building?
No, I have been doing that.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't have a problem Monday through Friday.
Yeah.
My concern is Friday night. Okay. What do I do between Friday night and Monday morning?
I don't think
that Xerox owns that point period
no,
of
don't.
My time.
I understand that, but and I don't think you should change, but I think you should be aware of that. There are 52 weekends in a year, and 2 years is 104 of them that
yes.
you're expected to be on this new assignment. You can build up some pretty strong relationships on a couple of those weekends.
Martins wants to make sure Warren succeeds. It helps pave the way for other minorities. His daughter, for example, who's also a Xerox employee.
They do it through mentoring, through caucuses, through a corporate culture that says diversity is important. And in fact, Xerox has been very successful at achieving diversity on the marketing side of the business. In fact, diversity is credited with making marketing a great success within the firm. On the engineering side, however, according to some, Xerox is in trouble as its key technology is under attack from digital imaging. But in engineering, it's hard to find technically skilled minorities. And many majority male managers are still stuck with the stereotypes of the past.
So in engineering, they work on these issues in management training. With a Cornell University theater troupe, they've turned racial conflict into a training skit.
Hello, Charles.
Gloria, hi.
Hi, thank you.
Based on a real incident, a white boss is about to assign his new black engineer to a very junior technician. He thinks he's protecting her from failure. She thinks he's snubbing her.
You're telling me that Ray Montgomery is going to keep you up to date on my work, giving you weekly reports on...
Yes, he will give me weekly reports and keep me up to date on how you're progressing. Okay?
I see. Well, I can't wait to get started on that, Charles.
Well, good.
In fact, the engineer is offended, as she explains in the debriefing session with the management audience.
I feel really exhausted, confused, angry, and tired.
Xerox's lesson here is that blacks must be allowed to sink or swim like everyone else. In character, the engineer delivers the message.
At this point, I don't need to be parented or diaper changed through my job. I'm a professional engineer. I know what I'm doing. All I want him to do, I'm not asking, okay, for the car. Just give me the keys. Let me test drive, okay?
At Xerox, they believe that managers like the Gloria character are worth accommodating. Vice President Debbie Smith says that's because diversity benefits the firm.
A team that's made up of heterogeneous individuals, of people coming from different backgrounds, who bring different talents and different abilities and different experiences to an organization, allow that team to be more successful because they can contribute in so many different ways. They have the flexibility to contribute. And all of those ideas coming together does lead to creativity and innovation. And that, I think, is a competitive advantage for us.
Members of the Roadshow think that black culture brings specific advantages.
In the African-American community, there is no hierarchical kind of relationship. Whether you are the vice president of engineering or the custodian, the janitor, the hourly, it didn't matter. We don't have a title kind of thing. Therefore, it's very comfortable for Bill as vice president and me as whatever level manager to eat together without any conflict. And we don't get worried about who's who and all that kind of stuff. Where, if you talk about the historically traditional community, white community, that isn't there. That has been built into them, has been bred into them.
Racial generalizations can obviously be dangerous even when they're positive. Are blacks really less hierarchical than whites? If so, is that an advantage? Do Asians have a special work ethic that somehow rubs off on other employees? Do Jews bring a special respect for education? You see how easily caricature could creep in here. And yet, different cultures obviously do have different strengths. Bring them together around a table and it simply stands to reason. You'll have a greater range of experiences and perspectives than, for want of a better comparison, a group of more homogeneous Japanese. But even if you don't buy all this stuff about diversity as competitive advantage, you still have to grant Xerox's main reason for nurturing it, the inexorably changing nature of the American workforce.
The issue is that America is in an economic war. It can't fight the economic war with one-third of its population, which is basically majority male. The issue is skills, the issue is ingenuity, the issue is how do you take an underutilized population that has been historically underutilized, that has not had the opportunities, and bring them into, in this case, a workforce where they can contribute to the corporation's objectives and goals.
Here's where the growth in the U.S. workforce is coming from. Between now and the year 2000, 92% of all new workers will be either women, Americans of color, or immigrants. The white male is becoming more and more of a minority. The question some people are asking, will these new groups produce the kind of skilled workforce America needs for global competition? To help his community, Roadshow member Kent Amos has informally adopted some 70 teenagers in a particularly tough part of Washington, D.C.
And we just got report cards. Mm-hmm. How'd you do, John?
My 7th period English, I had a C. And my 9th period SAT prep math, I had an A.
Right. Amos has invested personal time and his own money in the belief that blacks need to help each other onto and up the ladder. He believes the black community must upgrade itself first at home, then on the job.
When comes time to promote one of your own. That's nothing wrong with that. The issue is not whether they're competent or not. Everybody who's buying for the job ought to be competent. That's not the question. The question is, what's the difference? The difference is somebody that's going to be loyal to and can also make a difference in your community. That's very important.
As white corporate America begins to open up its system to other black people and other groups, as we approach the year 2000, they'll find that kids won't see their role models as Magic Johnson. They'll see their role models as Barry Rand and others. You follow me? Which is true in other groups. And I think for our society really to change, that we're going to have to begin to provide another vehicle for kids in our communities to be able to see that they can get out other than being one out of 12,000 in bouncing a basketball.
The task is obviously enormous, but the Roadshow and Xerox at least seem to be making a dent. And more to the point, they think we have no choice.
We don't understand that this is our last time at bat, that the numbers that you will project in your charts or that people have heard about in terms of what this workforce 2000 is going to look like, no one gets to vote on that. That's the way it's going to be. When 2000 shows up, that's the way it's going to be.
You're looking healthy, my friend.
Ever since the David Kearns era at Xerox, the idea has been to capitalize on diversity instead of just compensating for it. And to Roadshow member Kent Amos, the Xerox story shows how to do it and why.
So what it says is you can do all these things and win. And win. That's what's critical here that we understand. You don't lose by doing this. You win by doing this.